fighting has broken out between two former Soviet republics, Azerbaijan and Armenia, over the ethnic Armenian enclave of Nagorno-Karabakh. Hundreds of lives have been lost since fighting began September 27th. With much of the world distracted by a global pandemic and a bitter U.S. election campaign, this return to war now rages. Late today, the Kremlin, which once ruled these two nations, said that it wanted leaders from both sides to come to Moscow for talks. But in this small corner on the fringes of Europe, neighboring powers are becoming involved with unpredictable consequences. With support from the Pulitzer Center, special correspondent Simon Ostrovsky reports from Nagorno-Karabakh.
For over a week now, Armenians in the breakaway Nagorno-Karabakh Republic have cowered in shelters as bombs rain down on them from the sky.
They're shooting. Come over here. It's coming in close.
It's a bitter conflict between ethnic Armenians on one side and ethnic Azerbaijanis on the other, in a region where Turkey has taken an increased interest and its ambitions to be a regional power broker expand.
They've been shooting all day. They're destroying everything.
This is the first full-scale war that's taken place here since ethnic Armenians won control of Karabakh more than 25 years ago. But now, this small breakaway republic in the southern Caucasus threatens to pull in large and powerful regional powers. The neighboring Republic of Armenia is already in the fight on the side of their ethnic brethren in Karabakh, sending both troops and weapons. NATO member Turkey has thrown its weight behind its ally Azerbaijan, supplying high-tech arms as well as mercenaries from Syria, something Ankara denies. Absent from the battlefield for now is Armenia's ally Moscow, which ruled over both Armenia and Azerbaijan when war first broke out here as the Soviet Union dissolved in 1992, and Armenians demanded Karabakh become part of the Republic of Armenia. We managed to get into separatist Karabakh and its capital, Stepanakert, on Tuesday and Wednesday.
It's really hard to describe how terrifying it is when the city is being shelled. All you can think about is, how do I get low? How do I get safe?
The city is littered with various types of ordnance. A group of men show me a piece of a rocket that landed in a residential block.
It's Turkish, it's Turkish. And the main thing is that it's from an F-16.
F-16 bombing. F-16.
Many here believe Armenia's age-old enemy Turkey orchestrated this war and is using weapons, including some supplied by the United States, on the population of Karabakh. The Armenian prime minister has said as much himself.
According to our information, 150 top officials of the Turkish military are in different commanding positions of the Azerbaijani army, and they are commanding and leading the military.
But Turkey's not the only country supplying arms to Azerbaijan in its war to reconquer Karabakh. The weapon we found, for example, turned out to be a Soviet-made Grad missile. In fact, just under 3% of Azerbaijan's weapons come from Turkey. More than half of its weapons were imported from Russia over the last 5 years, and a further 41% of its arms purchases came from another U.S. ally, Israel. But Russia is the only major supplier of arms to both sides of this war. Nevertheless, many in Karabakh are holding out hope that Russia will intervene on their behalf.
Please tell our big brother Vladimir Putin to put his fist down to put them in their place. He knows how to do that.
Hope that he would grew dimmer after Putin yesterday told state television his country's treaty with Armenia doesn't cover Karabakh.
We have certain obligations under this agreement, but the fighting is not taking place on the territory of Armenia.
I asked the Armenian Defense Ministry spokesman what he thought of Russia supplying so much weaponry to Armenia's enemies.
Buying arms from someone, whether it's Russia or Israel, that's one thing. The Turks are actually fighting against us.
The human rights ombudsman of self-declared Karabakh, Artak Beglarian, called on the international community to cease weapons transfers to Azerbaijan.
with your armaments, civilians are largely and intentionally killed here, and Azerbaijan wants to make genocidal acts here against all Armenians. And that's why...
It's dangerous to be in the open.
Just as we begin our interview, we hear an attack drone circling overhead.
It's a suicide drone.
A cameraman guides Beglarian, who is partially blind, to cover in an adjacent ruin.
Hold on. Here, just stay here.
Okay. Our forces are trying to shoot down.
Several countries are supplying drones to Azerbaijan, among them Turkey and Israel.
Attacks on civilians haven't been limited to Armenian-controlled Karabakh. Ethnic Armenian forces have shelled several major cities on the government-controlled side of the front line as well. This footage was filmed in the city of Barda earlier today. In all, 30 civilians have been killed on the Azerbaijani side, according to official figures, compared to around 24 here. Military casualties are estimated to be in the hundreds. With no end to the fighting in sight, civilians have begun fleeing the area. An estimated 75,000 have run across the border to Armenia already. This elderly couple were on their way to stay with their daughter in the Armenian capital, Yerevan.
We couldn't leave the cellar. We couldn't even bathe.
There's no gas, no electricity. How long can you survive on bread alone?
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Simon Ostrovsky in Nagorno-Karabakh.